through our live streaming platforms, Base E-Program at Macedon Park, at the entrance of Lodium, Pretoria, Republic of South Africa. On behalf of the Institute for Islamic Services, its subsidiaries, Radio 1584, Medina Media, and all our platforms, including Masjid al-Haq, we would like to wish all Muslims a prosperous Eid al-Fitr. We also would like to ask for Maaf, that He forgive us for our shortcomings and weaknesses. And we hope that He will forgive us as well as bless us with your suggestions so that we may improve regarding our services, inshallah. Our speaker on this auspicious occasion of Eid al-Fitr is none other than the world-renowned Dr. Firoz Osman, an international world-renowned activist, a medical doctor by profession, an author, a writer, a presenter, a commentator on Zionist occupation of Palestine, and he is a founding member of the Media Review Network. And without much ado, let's not forget praying for the oppressed people of Palestine on this auspicious occasion. Dr. Firoz, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وآله وصحبه أجمعين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله tells us in Surah Al-Imran, Ayah 118, it says, O you who believe, do not hold other people as your confidants of the secrets to the exclusion of your own selves. They wish you to have hardships. So those who are not Muslims, Allah says, be wary of them. That they should have hardships against you. Gross hatred has already expressed itself through the utterance of their mouths. And what their hearts conceal is far worse. And Allah advises us, now we have explained the messages fully to you, if only you would use your reason, if you would understand. And we see today we are witnessing unimaginable brutality and savagery initiated and sustained by the Western world. Now, there was in 2001, 23 years ago, a four-star general. His name was Wesley Clark. He was a general in the army of NATO. And he found by chance when he was visiting, there was a document that was released, and there was an attempt to orchestrate a campaign to attack Muslim countries. And he said that we are going to take out 7 countries in 5 years, and the name them as Iraq, as Syria, in Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. Now just look at what has happened in the world today. Each and every one of these countries are filled with instability. Each and every one of these countries are destabilized, or attempting with the last one, Iran, that is going to be destabilized. And researchers have come up with a number, conservatively, that they have killed up to 5 million Muslims. That's a conservative estimate. Nassim Ahmed, the researcher based in the United Kingdom, has said that they have killed 5 million Muslims, because it is not only the words that they have uttered to attack the Muslims, but it is also action that has taken place that emanate from these reports. There was a general in NATO, his name was General Boykin, and he actually called Americans He was an American general in NATO, and he said, you know, the United States Army is a Christian army, and they declared that radical Islamists hated the United States, and the reasons he gave was because we are a Christian nation, because our foundation and our roots are Judeo-Christian, Judeo-Jewish and Christian, and the enemy is a guy called Satan, Satan being the Muslims. So Muslims have been declared the enemy of the West, and they have called it the Green Peril after the Red Peril. The Red Peril was the communists in Russia. The Green Peril, they gave it the color coded name for Islam. They call it political Islam, but it is represented by the Islamic movements. Anybody who opposed the West was known as a radical or a fundamentalist. If you were close to them, no problem. You were a moderate Muslim and they enlisted you to fight against the so-called Western countries. Now there are certain media that projected this. The Economist, which is a right-wing popular magazine, it wrote in a big headline, the Islamic threat. The New York Times, and you know it is one of the most popular newspapers, they put a full headline in 1996. It said, the Red Menace is gone, but here is Islam. In fact, if you go back in history, Theodor Herzl, one of the founders of the Zionist terrorist state of Israel, he said that the Jewish community, in order to persuade the West to support them, said they could have been a part of a wall of defense for Europe in Asia, an outpost of civilization against barbarism. The West, white European, are civilized as opposed to anybody who is brown and black, and they call them barbaric people. In fact, just recently, just last week, Boris Johnson, in one of the debates in the UK Parliament, he said that when they were debating whether they would still send arms to Israel in order to fight the Palestinians, he said, if we stop going the arms, stop the arms to go to Israel, it will be the death wish of the Western civilization. So he wanted the genocide in Israel to continue. This is the British. And I want to remind you that if you talk about the West people, they talk about the international community. What comprises the international community? If you think about it, you know, the white nations of the West, the United States of America, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, they comprise of less than 10% of the world. 90% of the world is in fact dark, black and brown people. And majority of them who are resisting what the Western world is doing today are the Muslims. So they are really in the vanguard of the fight against the Western world. Thomas Friedman, you may know some of him, how influential he is of the New York Times. And he said, clearly declared, he says, we want a war within Islam. Not a war with Islam, within Islam. Within Islam meaning what? That you want a Muslim country to fight another Muslim country. This is a war, as they say, Israel is fighting Hamas. It's not only fighting Hamas. Previously they said we were fighting Al-Qaeda. Then they said they were fighting Taliban. But it is not fighting Islamic Jihad or Hamas or Hezbollah. They are fighting Islam. And we need to understand that. There was an author by the name of Randall Price. He wrote a book called Unholy War. And he said in 2002 that we asked the question, is the war, United States of America waging a war with Islam? He said it isn't. And if it is, it should be waging a war. So we find that this war is not only confined to the Middle East. You know, just a few years ago, a few decades, two decades ago, there was a war that took place in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Now, you know, in that place, 100,000 Muslims, they were blonde, they were blue-eyed, but they were Muslim. 100,000 men were killed. 60,000 women were put into rape camps and rape until they gave birth to Serbians. So you must remember that this is war not confined to the Middle East only, but in Europe as well, and South Africa is not immune to it. I want to remind you of one or two incidences. When the elections were taking place here, they said that Islamic fundamentalists was coming here. You may recall that there was a bomb blast that took place in Cape Town, at Planet Hollywood it was called at that time. Without any evidence, just as soon as the bomb went off, they blamed the Muslim fundamentalists. World Cup took place, again they blamed the Muslim. There was a soccer match in Rustenburg, United States, Britain were playing against another team. I forget which team. But they already said that there was going to be a bomb blast that was taking place there. And it never happened. Each time we asked, produce the evidence, there was no evidence that came. And the Star newspaper, one of the biggest in South Africa, there was a columnist by the name of J.J. Cornish. He said that the threat to national security from radical Islamists was happening in South Africa. So this is an issue that is not only in the Middle East, it is not only in Europe, it is not only in America, it is coming to South Africa. And they say, they call us fundamental Islamic groups that are coming here. There was a headline, I remember, in the Citizen that took place. They talked about secret training camps in South Africa. They actually investigated it, and they found it was paintball that was taking place there eventually. But by that time, they created a fear amongst the people in South Africa that Muslims are training to create disunity and destabilize the entire country. So this demonization takes place now. It didn't even start at the time of the Crusades. All the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of them, from Nuh alayhi salam to Musa alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, they all underwent tests, they all underwent trials in order to bring the message of truth and justice. The question that they ask is, are we at war with Islam? They say most definitely not. But Islam is at war with us. Us meaning the Christians, us meaning the Western countries. And that it has been at war ever since the days of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what they say. This is the Western psyche. It is embedded deeply into the Western world. And the enemies have made deep studies of the Muslims. One of the weaknesses we have is that we Muslims do not study our enemies. But they have studied us very well. There are a couple of studies. I'll just quote one or two for you. There is a study known as Hearts, Minds and Dollars. They push in millions of dollars in order to change the mind of the Muslim. But the one I want to bring to notice is one called Civil Democratic Islam. It is edited by Cheryl Bernard of the RAND Corporation. It is the National Security Division, a think tank that is based in the United States of America. And when they studied Islam, they studied it so well that they know Islam better than you and me. And they said, what are the attitudes of Islam towards certain things, like democracy? What do they think about criminal punishment, you know, the chopping of their hands, of Islamic justice, of the minorities? How do they treat the minorities? About hijab? What do they think about women's dresses and so on? Are Muslims, are their husbands allowed to beat up their women and their wives and so on? So they studied this, they took the attitude, and then they divided the Muslim into orthodox, into fundamentalists, into progressives, into modernists and so on. And they said, okay, these are the people, the modernists and the progressives are closer to us. We will nurture them. So they start developing these people to become and seats in universities and produce their books and publish their books so that it gets currency amongst the ordinary people. Fundamentalists are the most dangerous because they believe in jihad, they believe in armed resistance. Orthodox are okay, but how do we create friction between the orthodox and the fundamentalists? They even train ulama to come and create this friction. So there is complicity also as they develop between certain of the countries like today, Egypt, Jordan, Emiratis and Saudis. They are supporting the Israelis to kill the Muslims. The ceiling of Rafah is done by the Egyptians. Thousands of people that are coming from Jordan are being arrested and shot at by the Jordanians because they want to go across the border. Iraqis are pleading, let us go and help the Palestinians. We want to go. They are blocked by their own countries. And of course, Saudi Arabia, probably the richest of them all, they are the ones that have purchased arms to an extent nobody else in the world has purchased. Why? To protect who? Not a single bullet can go through. Not a single drop of water from the Nile can go to the Palestinians. We need to think of who and how and why this is happening. These are the puppet rulers of the West. They are given the arms to protect their own people from rising against them. And this is what is happening in Jordan as well. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in Surah Imran in verse 146 that how many a prophet has fought in Allah's cause, and they are followed by the ulama, by the scholars, the religious scholars, and they do not come faint-hearted, and they do not become weak in Allah's cause. They had to suffer in Allah's cause. And neither did they weaken, nor did they submit themselves before the enemy. They didn't. Since Allah loves those who are patient in adversity. So yes, we are saddened. We are terrified when we see that. We can't even see those images that are emerging from Gaza. But it doesn't mean weakness. It means sadness. Look what happened just yesterday. Ismail Haniyeh, the leader of Hamas, they shot his children. They bombed him. Three of his sons and three of his grandchildren were going on to spend time, and they killed them. And what was the response of his brother? That they have been granted, they have been honored for the martyrdom. Now this is the immense faith of some of those who are fighting in Gaza, that they have been granted Jannah. Now there was a woman who had four sons, all of them were imprisoned and killed subsequently. And she was asked, how do you feel now? About you're alone, you have no son, you have no husband. She said, I wish Allah had granted me another four children so that they could fight in the cause of Allah against the Zionist occupiers. This is the depth of what is happening there. There is light at the end of the tunnel. All this picture I have painted to you is not only doom and gloom. You find Hamas, you find Islamic Jihad, Hezbollah, and Ansarullah. The weakest Arab country, Yemen, has crippled the Haifa port of Israel. There is no good that are going through. And you know what is ironic? That the goods for Israel needs is going through Emirates, Saudi Arabia, along the land corridor, they call it Jordan, into Israel. So you can see who are those who are complicit. Complicit with Israel. Now, there are one or two incidences when Ismail Haniyeh died and he said, this will not change our attitude towards what is happening in Gaza. Our conditions remain the same. And I'm reminded by certain incidences that happened during the time of Rasulullah, that at one stage, the Quraysh approached Rasulullah's uncle, Abu Talib, and they said, you know, he's creating friction, he's creating disunity amongst ourselves. And Abu Talib called Rasulullah and told him that this is what I've been approached with. And he told him that do not put me a burden greater than I can bear. Rasulullah, when he was approached by his uncle, thought that his uncle was going to abandon him, he's going to remove the protection from him. And he said to his uncle that even if they put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left, on condition that I abandon this cause before Allah has made it victorious or I perish therein, I will not abandon it. Now this is the state of I see that is emerging amongst those in Gaza that are fighting. There was another incident where Utbah bin Rabia went to Rasulullah and he says, you are creating so many problems. Let us do certain things. Let us, if what you want is wealth, we all look rich, we will collect all the wealth so that you will be the richest amongst us. If you want honor, we will make you the leader, and no decision that we will make without you, so we will grant you the honor. If it is sovereignty you want, then we will make you our king. And if it is an illness that you have, then we will collect all our wealth until you get cured. Rasulullah said, listen to you. And he said eventually that, you know, he recited Surah Fusilat, and he said, and he warned them that this is a punishment that is going to befall you. And he of course didn't order. And we know from Surah Al-Kafirun, they said, we will follow your religion 1 year, you follow our religion, let us compromise. There was no compromise with him. He said, lakum dinukum wa liya din. This is my way, this is your way, you follow your way. So in conclusion then, we have emerged from the month of fasting. We have spent a month of rigorous, high-intensity training. We have learned the way discipline to be organized, to be focused, or we should have learned it, to be determined, to be steadfast. And this is what is happening for the people in Gaza. They are teaching us lessons. Their resistance and their struggle is actually a struggle of us against all tyranny. It is a struggle of all those oppressed all over the world. We are learning from the heroes and heroines of Gaza, and we believe that inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us the strength to emulate them, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them victory. So Allah tells us in the Quran in Surah Al-Anfal, it says, "For my nasr illa min indillah, and victory is not but from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Fa'ati tawana, wa'ala al-hamdu ila inna Allah.
قد أفلح من بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله أكبر.
سمع
الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. 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 الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية وجوه يومئذ خاشعة عاملة ناصبة تصلى نارا حامية تسقى من عين آنية ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية فيها عين جارية فيها سرر مرفوعة وأكواب موضوعة ونمارق مصفوفة وزرابي مبثوثة أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت وإلى السماء كيف رفعت وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت فذكر إنما أنت مذكر لست عليهم بمسيطر إلا من تولى وكفر فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر إن إلينا إيابهم ثم إن علينا حسابهم. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله. الله اكبر الله اكبر الله اكبر. لا اله الا الله الله اكبر الله اكبر ولله الحمد. الله اكبر الله اكبر الله اكبر. لا اله الا الله الله اكبر الله اكبر ولله الحمد. الله اكبر الله اكبر. لا اله الا الله الله اكبر ولله الحمد.
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحده وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والارحام ان الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم اعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. اما بعد، الله اكبر الله اكبر. لا اله الا الله الله اكبر ولله الحمد. الله اكبر عدد ما صام صائم وافطر. الله اكبر عدد ما ذكر الله ذاكر وكبر. الله اكبر عدد ما حمد الله حامد وشكر. الله اكبر ما صدح فجر الاسلام واصفر. الله اكبر ما اقبل شهر الصيام وادبر. الله اكبر ما فرح الصائم باتمام صيامه واستبشر. الله اكبر عدد ما تائب واستغفر. الله اكبر كبيرا والحمد لله كثيرا وسبحان الله بكره واصيلا. ايها المسلمون عباد الله، كنا بالامس القريب نستقبل ضيفا عزيزا وشهرا مباركا، وهذا اليوم قد ودعناه واستقبلناه العيد. واعلموا ان اعيادنا امه الاسلام من شعائر الظاهره. فعن انس رضي الله عنه قال: قدم صلى الله عليه وسلم المدينه ولهم يومان يلعبون فيهما، فقال: ما هذان اليومان؟ قالوا: كنا نلعب فيهما في الجاهليه. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم: ان الله ابداكم بهما خيرا منهما، يوم الاضحى ويوم الفطر. رواه ابو داود والنسائي. واعلموا ان العيد يوم الجوائز، فهنيئا للمقبولين. الله اكبر الله اكبر. لا اله الا الله الله اكبر ولله الحمد. الحمد لله على احسانه وشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشانه، واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا الى يوم الدين. الله اكبر الله اكبر. لا اله الا الله الله اكبر ولله الحمد. اما بعد، فان انتهى شهر الصيام فما زال الصيام مشروعا، ومن ذلك صيام سته من شوال. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في فضلها: من صام رمضان ثم اتبعه سته من شوال كان كصيام الدهر. وكذلك يوم الاثنين والخميس وأيام العيد من كل شهر وغيرها من أنواع الصيام تطوع. وإن انتهت تراويح فما زال قيام الليل مشروعا وهو دأب الصالحين. فاغتنموا يا عباد الله الأعمار والأزمان وتقربوا إلى الله بالحسنات والطاعات، فإن من أعمال فإن من علامات قبول الحسنة فعل الحسنة بعدها. وتذكروا عباد الله قوله تعالى: ولتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون. فقد أكملنا العدة وكبرنا الله وبقي الشكر، فاشكروا الله على نعمه بقلوبكم وألسنتكم وأعمالكم، واشكروا الله على أن هداكم للإيمان، واشكروا الله أن وفقكم الصيام رمضان وقيامه، واشكروا الله على نعمة الأمن والإيمان. أيها المسلمون، في هذه العيد يمر إخواننا في فلسطين في غزة المقصود بحرب أبدية وهمجية لم يشهد مثلها التاريخ من اليهود الغاصبين، لكننا نوقن أن العاقبة للمتقين، أن العاقبة للمؤمنين، وأن النصر من عند الله سبحانه وتعالى. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا تقوم الساعة حتى يقاتل المسلمون اليهود فيقتلهم المسلمون حتى يقتل اليهود من وراء الحجر والشجر. فيقول الحجر أو الشجر يا مسلم: يا عبد الله، هذا يهودي خلفي، فتعال فاقتله. اللهم نزل الختام ونجري الصحابة هازم الأحزاب. اللهم اهزم اليهود الغاصبين وزلزل الأرض من تحتهم ودمرهم تدميرا. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في فلسطين وثبت أقدامهم وانصرهم على القوم الكافرين. اللهم اشف مرضاهم وعاف مبتلاهم وأطعم جائعهم ودام جرحاهم وتقبل موتاهم في الشهداء. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.
تحب العفو فاعف عنا يا كريم. اللهم إنا نسألك رضاك والجنة ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم أجرنا من النار. اللهم أجرنا من النار. اللهم أجرنا من النار. ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب إن عذابها كان غراما إنها ساءت مستقرا ومقاما. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة. اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة. اللهم اجعلنا ممن عفوت عنهم وغفرت لهم ورضيت عنهم وحرمت النار على أجسادهم وكتبتهم من المعتوقين. اللهم انصر إخواننا في غزة. اللهم انصرهم. اللهم انصرهم يا خير الحافظين. اللهم اجعل لهم من كل هم فرجا ومن كل ضيق مخرجا ومن كل بلاء عافية. اللهم ارحم موتاهم وشهداءهم ودافي وداوي وعافي وشافي مرضاهم وجرحاهم إنك على كل شيء قدير. اللهم رب ارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. اللهم رب أنر قبورهم وأنس وحشتهم وأكرم نزلهم ووسع مدخلهم واجعل قبورهم روضة من رياض الجنة. اللهم رب ارحمنا وارحمهم يوم لا ظل إلا ظلك يا ذا العرش الكريم. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الغر الميامين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Thank you. Sta